La primera audiencia del día de hoy, que está referida al caso 12545 y Samu Carlos Shibayama y otros contra los Estados Unidos. Soy Francisco Iguren, presidente de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. Me acompañan en la mesa la comisionada Margaret May McCauley, primera vicepresidenta y relatora para los Estados Unidos, y el comisionado Paulo Vannucchi. Está previsto para esta audiencia que recibamos dos declaraciones. La primera de ellas corresponde a la presunta víctima, don Isamu Shibayama. ¿Se encuentra presente? ¿Puede pasar allí? ¿Está preparado para que pase allí? No. ¿O va a dar su declaración desde allí? Donde tenga el micro, sí. ¿Me escucha bien? Bien. Buenos días, yes. Señor Shibayama.
Good morning.
¿Cómo está? Le agradecer.
Thank you.
Oh, me too, thank you. Le agradeceremos que nos sirva proporcionar su nombre completo, su lugar de nacimiento y su lugar de residencia.
My name is Isamu Arthur Shibayama, and I was born in Lima, Peru. But now I am a American.
Okay.
And I'm 86 years old.
Okay. Corresponde ahora que usted brinde su declaración por el término de hasta 10 minutos. Adelante.
My name is Paul Mills. I'm an attorney, and I, with Grace Shimizu, will be representing the petitioners today. With the permission of the commission, we were expecting that Mr. Shibayama would respond to questioning from Ms. Shimizu. Is that mm-hmm. all right? Okay.
Yes. Yes, I will say. Bueno, vamos a empezar la declaración. No se encuentra presente el Estado, pero proseguiremos con esta audiencia, con las declaraciones y con los alegatos, y se dejará constancia de la inasistencia del Estado. Podemos proceder entonces. ¿Dónde está el aparato este? Necesito el aparato. ¿Dónde está?
Excuse me. Another issue that has arisen is because of the absence of the member state, would it be possible for us to extend our questioning time to include theirs?
Mire, manejémonos con el tiempo originalmente previsto. Si necesitamos, lo extendemos un poco más. Pero duplicar los tiempos, honestamente, no creo que sea, no tenga sentido. Sí estamos dispuestos a escuchar lo que sea necesario, pero tratemos de sujetarnos al tiempo, porque como luego también nosotros podremos preguntar, podemos manejarnos con cierta libertad. Si es necesario, lo extendemos.
Thank you.
Like, okay. Mr. Shibayama, you've been waiting many years for justice. Is there something that you'd like to say to the commission before we start?
Thank you for giving us this hearing.
And where are your brothers now? They're the other petitioners.
My brothers are, they couldn't come here today because they're suffering from dementia and poor health.
Okay. So you and your family were subjected to many violations during World War II. Mr. Shibayama, are you familiar with the documentary called Hidden Internment, the
Yes.
Art Shibayama story?
Yes.
Okay. And you've had a chance to see this documentary?
Yes.
And so does the documentary fairly and accurately depict your family home and business?
Yes.
The type of transport you were on, the barracks you were housed in, the guard towers and camp?
Yes.
In Seabrook? Okay. Now, we understand that your grandparents were one of the first Japanese to be taken from Peru, and that they were put in a Department of Justice camp in the United States, and they were used as part of the hostage exchange for U.S. citizens held in Japan. How did that make you feel when that happened?
I was really sad because I was raised partially by my grandparents. And they were used in one of the hostage exchanges. So after they left Peru, I never saw them again.
Mm-hmm. And so when you and your family were seized from your home in Peru, and you were stripped of your passports and legal documents, and forcibly transported on a U.S. Army ship under armed guard to New Orleans, and then later the U.S. government classified you on entry as an illegal alien. How did this illegal alien status affect you, particularly at Seabrook Farms?
In Seabrook, they took 30% tax, so my father, working by himself, couldn't make enough to afford to feed the family. So, and my mother was pregnant, so she couldn't work at the time. So one of my sister and us and myself have to go to work to help the family. So our education was, we could go to school.
Mm-hmm. So while you were still classified as an illegal alien, I understand you served during the Korean War and that your section leader wanted you to get you a security clearance, so he applied for your citizenship on your behalf. What happened?
I was denied citizenship because the government claimed that we didn't have a legal entry. Now the government brought us in, so how can that be illegal entry?
So we have a little more time here. So maybe you could describe a little more about what happened, of your experience. Like perhaps you could share with us what happened to your mother and your sister when your father went into hiding.
Oh, when the U.S. Army transport came into Callao, words got around, and head of the family went into hiding. And the police came to, my father included, the police came to our house a few times, and again, not finding my father, they took my mother and put her in jail. My sister, who was 11 at the time, went with her because she didn't want our mother to go by herself. So she said that she told me that they were put in a cell with criminals and prostitutes. So this is so they were so afraid, and so they hug each other and they cried all night.
Thank you. And so are there other experience that you would like to share about your experience?
Well, since I was classified illegal alien, which I never was, I want the government to erase my illegal alien status from my record.
And could you explain more why you think that is important for the government to do?
Because I don't want the government to use it against me in the future.
And I know that you've been struggling for redress a long time. It's been, I guess, since the 1980s, right? We've been struggling. And what has it meant for you, you know, that the government has continually resisted acknowledging what happened?
Well, the government keep classifying us as illegal alien when we didn't do it. I mean, we came in here. Actually, the government brought us here at gunpoint, so how can they classify us as illegal alien?
Thank you. Oh, could you please give us a little description of the camp that you were interned in?
The camp, we had a 20-foot fence all the way around us with with guard tower in each corner with machine guns and rifles, and we couldn't go out.
And how old were you at the time?
I was 13.
Mm-hmm. And how about your brothers? How old were they?
They were 9 and 10 and 8.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Why don't you ask? And during that time, were you able to get any education when you're inside such a camp?
Well, in camp, they only had a Japanese school and English school. And since we spoke Spanish, and English wasn't used much in Peru in those days, so our parents sent us to Japanese schools.
Mm-hmm. And during that time, what was it like as a child to be held behind those kind of barbed wire?
Well, I don't think it affected us kids as much as it did the parents or the older kids. But for us young ones, it was, you know, just like outside, going to school, and then after school, we come home and we play some kind of sports. So I don't think it affected us as much as the older ones.
Mm-hmm. And what did you see, though, in terms of the impact on the older children and your parents?
Oh, it affected them quite a bit because, especially my father, he had a good business back home, and then he had to come here, especially like in Seabrook. We have to work during the peak season, we have to work 2 hours a day, 7 days a week, changing from day to night shift every 2 weeks. So it was really hard on them.
And were you able to get any education in Seabrook?
No, because I had to work. And since we were working 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, so we had no time to go to school, actually.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
Our next witness will be Mr. Shibayama's daughter, Becky Shibayama, and I'll go collect her.
Pero primero podemos
hacerle... I'm sorry, yes.
Okay. Margaret, if you want to make some...
Yes, thank you. Mr. President, thank you. Mr. Shibayama, you became a citizen of the United States?
In 1970.
In
1970.
70. Did you take steps to try to erase the description of you as an illegal alien who entered the country illegally? Did you take any steps at all to try and remove that from your record?
No, not really to remove that from the record, but when we were trying to get the citizenship, you know, we really worked hard on that because we were denied so many times.
From when did you try to do that?
From the time we got out of camp, and then since the Peruvian, we wanted to go back to Peru, but the Peruvian government wouldn't allow us to get into the country. So then we had to stay here, and that's when I started fighting for citizenship.
When did you get out of camp?
1940s. 1946.
Did your parents ever get citizenship or permanent residence?
No, they were Japanese citizens. So
they
were Japanese citizens.
They could not.
They were born in Japan.
Yes, but they could.
So they didn't
apply.
They didn't apply for U.S. citizenship. No.
Okay.
No.
But you and your brothers did.
Yes.
Did. Yes. And it was in 1970 that you eventually got it.
I got it in 1970, but I don't know about my brothers.
Mm-hmm. But you know they got theirs.
Pardon?
But you know that they got their citizenship.
Yes.
Yes. But not when.
Because they were in Chicago and I moved to California.
Uh-huh.
See, so when I decided to move to California, I thought I better get my citizenship because I didn't want to go through the whole thing all over again.
Right. Yes. You applied to some courts in America so that you could be compensated for your internment, first of all, the fact that you were captured and forcibly brought to the States and then interred. Did you ever receive any compensation?
No. They offer us $5,000 and a letter of apology. But I refused because it was equal to the Japanese Americans, which they received 20,000. Mm-hmm. And the letter apology, their letter, they had a presidential stamp on there. Mm-hmm. And our apology, it was just plain paper, plain white paper, and didn't say anything about being a Japanese Peruvian or Japanese or even Peruvians. Mm-hmm. So the letter didn't mean anything.
Right. So in other words, if I understand you right, you felt that since you had been taken in your country of Peru at the time, captured there and brought forcibly in a war naval ship to America and interned in a camp, that you ought to have been treated better, in fact, than those who were here and kept here.
Right.
Yes.
Because in our case, like, we didn't even speak the language.
Quite. And your grandparents, who you said were exchanged.
Right.
Did you or your family ever file any proceedings or claims about the fact that they were exchanged and you never saw them again?
No.
And the loss to your family?
As far as I know.
No.
No.
And you still feel a sense of being deprived, being discriminated against, being abused by what happened to you?
Yes. And yes, because actually my grandparents raised me from the time I was 1.5 or 2 to around 5. Yeah. My grandparents live in Callao, mm-hmm. and my parents live in Lima. Mm-hmm. And so then around when I turned 5, mm-hmm. I went back to my parents to go to school in Lima.
Yes. So what is it that you wish to have from the commission? What are you looking for?
Well, to give us equal justice, mm-hmm. you know, like the regular American or whatever.
Like the Japanese Americans right. were treated,
at least
that much, but maybe a little more.
Right.
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias, comisionada May McCulley. Mm-hmm. Ahora va a hacer unas preguntas la secretaria ejecutiva adjunta Elizabeth Abimuchart.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's just a very brief follow-up question, and I'll address you in English. Thank you for your testimony. With me, you don't have to worry about the translation. Yeah.
Oh, English.
Yes. Thank you for your testimony.
Okay.
I just wanted to follow up with a question. When you and your brothers decided to pursue compensation through litigation, what is it that you and your brothers were hoping to achieve through the litigation process?
Well, we decided to sue the government so this kind of things won't happen again, whether they're a different group of people or whatever. But to do that to a people that innocent people and put them in camps like that and retain them for so many years. I don't think that's right. Because they didn't make it, they didn't go through any crime or anything.
And since the litigation ultimately was unsuccessful, with your lawyers, did you and your brothers consider any other kind of legal action? Did you understand that it would be possible to pursue any other kind of legal action? Or did you understand that you had pursued the only legal action available to you?
Yes, I think that's about it.
Thank you very much.
Bien, yo me siento satisfecho con las preguntas formuladas por la comisionada y la secretaria ejecutiva adjunta, que han esclarecido parte de la información que yo hubiera querido escuchar. Solamente le diré que creo interpretar el sentido y el sentimiento de las personas que integramos la comisión al expresarle nuestra solidaridad, nuestro sincero pesar por las injustas condiciones que usted tuvo que sufrir. Y a mí me molesta mucho más y me apena mucho más porque lo hicieron en mi país y lo trajeron acá. Así que mis disculpas, aunque yo no tenga nada que ver en ello, pero creo que es un reconocimiento histórico. No me estoy adelantando a lo que dirá la comisión, pero es un sentimiento personal. Disculpas. Vamos a proceder a la declaración de la siguiente testigo. ¿Puede usted retirarse, señor Isamu?
Gracias. Muchas gracias.
Corresponde ahora que recibamos la declaración de Becky Shibayama. Antes de empezar, le agradeceré si nos puede indicar su nombre completo, su lugar de nacimiento y su lugar de residencia.
Good morning. My name is Becky Shibayama, and I am the daughter of Arthur Shibayama. I was born in Chicago, Illinois, and I now reside in Sunnyvale, California.
Corresponde que antes de recibir su declaración le tome juramento. Okay. Y le voy a preguntar, le voy a pedir que usted me responda si jura o promete decir la verdad sobre los hechos respecto de los cuales va a rendir su declaración. Muy bien. Muy bien. Pueden entonces dar inicio a su interrogatorio.
Sí. Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Ms. Shibayama.
Good morning.
How old were you when you learned of your father's and uncle's wartime experiences? How old were you at that time?
I was approximately 11 years old when I learned the details about how the U.S. government kidnapped, deported, and imprisoned my father and his family.
And how did you witness, what did you witness as far as the impact of these experiences on you and your family members?
Myself, I actually, perhaps for the first time in my life, I felt fearful for my own safety. It was actually a personal violation and vulnerability that I had not felt before. And my brother and I were confronted with the harsh reality of racial oppression, and we felt defenseless. But more shocking for me was when I later realized that this feeling or this theme of insecurity ran through my entire family's persona. Suddenly the words with liberty and justice for all that I recited in grade school every morning rang hollow. I wondered how my government could take my family's basic freedoms and human rights away. My father and his family had done nothing wrong. Their only supposed crime was that they were of Japanese descent, and the US government had a needed excuse to take them as hostages to be used in exchange for Americans being held in Japan. Quite honestly, I cannot say that our family has handled the trauma of these wartime experiences very well. There's still a veil of denial, and it still haunts us and still makes us feel angry and frustrated whenever we think of the injustices that our family had to face.
Can you tell the commission, please, what you witnessed as far as the impact of your grandfather's death following these experiences?
Sure. So, oops.
Oh, right. Yeah, during my questioning, you don't need your headphones.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. So, tragically, my grandfather died in 1976 at the age of 70. At the time, he was suffering from a severe depression, so it was very sad and upsetting for the entire family. After the Shibayama's deportation from Peru, my grandfather spent the rest of his life trying to regain everything that he had lost in Peru. It wasn't until after my grandfather had already passed that our family really appreciated all that he had gone through as the patriarch of the family. His whole world was actually turned upside down at the hands of the US government. Our hearts break when we think of the tremendous losses and struggles that he was forced to bear, and the shame of not being able to protect his wife and his children from the unspeakable hardships must have weighed heavy on his heart. To this day, my family and I believe that the US government killed my grandfather's spirit. After his capitulation, and from then on, he was never the same man again. Gradually, he became silently entombed in a world of pain and isolation. I only knew him as a shell of his original self, and I just wish that I had shown him more love when I had had the chance. Sorry.
Could you please, let me know when you're ready to
okay.
go on.
Just a second.
Thank okay,
you.
All right. I understand this is difficult for you, and just take your time.
Thank you.
Please tell the commission what you have witnessed as far as what it has meant to you and your family as your father, who's just testified, pursued justice over the last, I guess, 30 years.
My family and I are very proud of my father for his pursuit for justice and for his courage to hold the US government accountable for its wrongdoing. We are proud that he is fighting to ensure that history is not repeated. And although it has been emotionally draining for him, especially at this age, to relive his experiences, he continues to make the sacrifice to fight for our human rights.
And finally, based on what you have witnessed, please tell the Commission how you feel the USA government should be held accountable for what it did in this incident.
Despite my father's and others' efforts to educate the American public, the Japanese-Peruvian internment is still widely unknown. In school, my brother and I were never taught about what the U.S. government did to the Japanese people living in Peru. We have learned from our parents and our aunts and uncles about their wartime experiences. But even so, my family and I do not know much of what had happened. That is why the U.S. government needs to provide a complete and thorough account of what it did. We need access to all documents and all reports of conversations, conferences, and legal proceedings. My brother and I and my cousins want to know what happened to my father, my aunts and uncles, my grandfather, and my great-grandparents. We know they suffered, and we want to know why. We need the U.S. government to apologize and acknowledge what it did. We need educational funds, and we need full disclosure. So what happened to the Japanese Peruvians will not happen to my family, to any other family, or to any other group again.
Okay. Ms. Shibayama, I'm going to ask you to put your earphones on now, because the commission would like to question you.
You don't need the phones.
Okay.
Oh, you're going to get it. Okay, sorry.
I'm the country rapporteur, so I go first. I must say, Ms. Shibayama. Yes. You look a lot like your dad.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, so you we can't make a mistake about that. And I want to ask in particular one question. What do you know about your great-grandparents and what happened to them? Do you know anything about that?
Yes.
And how do you feel about the fact, I assume you didn't know them in person?
No, I never had the chance to meet them. Mm-hmm. But I know that they lived in Callao, and they actually raised my father from the age of about 2 to 5. Mm-hmm. And he was very close to them. When he was school age, he spent his summers with them, and he would go swimming with them. They had a business, mm-hmm. so they had a merchandise store. Mm-hmm. And so he would hang around with them. But he was actually so close to them that he almost considered them as his parents. Mm-hmm. Since they were living in Callao, which is on the coast, they were one of the first Japanese to be taken and deported out of Peru. And they were taken to an internment camp mm-hmm. in Texas called Segoville. Mm-hmm. And later, before my father's family even came, before they were brought to Crystal City, Texas, my great-grandparents were part of a hostage exchange. They were part of the second hostage exchange. So they were forcibly sent back to Japan. And I know that they went back to live with their son, who was, since It was in Japan. It was a war-torn country. The son was struggling to support his family, so it was a burden to have his parents come back. And we didn't find out until later that our great-grandparents didn't even tell their son what had happened. There was so much shame that they wouldn't even tell them. So the son actually wondered why did they have to come back, because it put an additional burden on his family.
Well, could you try to describe for us what you felt about not having met your great-grandparents and not ever having a relationship with them? Because I do understand that Japanese families have a close familial relationship to the oldest down to the youngest. So what did you, can you describe for us, did you feel a sense of loss? What did you feel
about
this? Yes,
definitely a sense of loss. Since I know that my father was so close to them and that they had raised him, all I know about are the photos that I see. So I really feel like I have lost the opportunity to meet them and to have a close relationship with them.
You said that you and your brother feel a strong sense or determination in what you're seeking from the U.S. state government, that you want to know all about what happened.
Yes.
This is because you want to know the truth about what happened, or just what happened in the whole circumstance, or just what happened to your father and mother?
Well, I really want to know the complete story, because we know that they suffered and they went through hardships. So I would like to know, I would like to know how the government made these decisions to take them out. You know, what were those decisions based on? What information was there? And so I would like to just, know what we should be looking out for in case our government starts going in that direction again. History has a tendency to repeat itself, so I just want to ensure, or try to ensure, that it doesn't happen again.
And this desire to know, is it based on your certainty that you have a right to the truth?
Yes.
And this is why you're asking, this is one of the things you're asking for.
Yes, that's
an
correct.
An exercise of that right. You also... your family lost a great deal. They lost their financial security, their physical freedom, their dignity, which is very important to all people, but one knows and reads how important it is to Japanese persons, and so much more. What do you think, apart from what you said, would repair in some way, because you can't completely repair any harm like that, in some way, what has happened to your father, his brothers, his siblings, and the loss of his parents, and you, this younger generation, of the family, what in total you think should be, because of all the loss suffered?
Well, I think one of the things that we would like to see is full redress for the Japanese Peruvians, since they were excluded from the Civil Liberties Act. We would like to see that they receive full redress. And then, as I mentioned, we would like to see educational funds so that the Japanese Peruvian or the Japanese Latin American internment, and the entire story is included
published.
included in textbooks and also part of the curriculum in schools.
I think that is. Thank you.
Sorry. One more thing.
Yes.
I'm not sure if my father was able to mention it, but one thing we would like to see is have the illegal alien status removed from his government records.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Because that's important.
Yes, he did. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for granting this hearing for my father and my uncles.
Elisa, yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's just a brief follow-up question. You've mentioned the importance of having access to information from U.S. government records, and I wondered if you are aware of efforts on the part of your father and his brothers or on the part of other people who are in this situation to ask for this information, to actively seek this information, and whether you are aware of difficulties in obtaining it. If you could describe a little bit that question.
I'm sorry. I actually don't know if that was done. Yeah, I'm sorry.
No, we just are trying to get all of the information that we can. The second question has to do with the court case that your father and his brothers brought under the Civil Liberties Act. And I'm wondering if you could, considering the results of that court case, if you could describe whether that's had an impact as well on the family, whether the court case, the search for justice, specifically in the context of litigation, whether the results of that, the process of that, has had an effect on you and the family.
Yes.
Thank you.
To be quite frank, I think the fact that he has been denied so many times for redress, we felt robbed. It was just like a continuation of what had happened to them previously. And I know when my father did not receive redress, he was devastated. And my mother, who was born in the U.S., received redress herself. However, she felt very upset that my father and his family didn't receive it because she felt that they had been made to suffer more. So, it's been pretty rough, pretty disappointing that it's taken this long and still the U.S. government hasn't apologized for its wrongdoing.
Okay.
Just a follow-up with the Executive Secretary's question.
Yes.
Did you ever seek to obtain information through legislation giving you a right to apply for information? Maybe your lawyers should answer.
Yeah, I was going to say I'm not.
Well,
I'm
in your closing submissions, perhaps you can deal with that.
Okay.
Muchas gracias. Puede usted retirarse. You can.
Thank you very much.
Bueno, prosiguiendo con esta audiencia, corresponde ahora que se puedan realizar los alegatos por parte de los representantes de los peticionarios, hasta por un tiempo de 15 minutos, luego probablemente hagamos algún tipo de preguntas. Entonces, no sé si lo van a compartir o quién lo va a realizar, pero pueden dar inicio a la formulación de sus alegatos.
Thank you. I'd like to thank on behalf of the petitioners, the distinguished members of the commission for giving us this opportunity to discuss these issues. I also want to thank our honored guests for attending and doing what we need done, which is that
the statements of the witnesses and the facts of this case be heard. As I said before, my name is Paul Mills, and I'm an attorney who has assisted in some of these cases over the years. With me is the director of the Japanese Peruvian Oral History Project, which we may refer to later as the JPOHP, Ms. Grace Shimizu. I will speak briefly, and then I will turn over the remainder of the 15 minutes to Ms. Shimizu. It's clear that the commission doesn't need for me to reiterate the contours of this incident, the history that we're talking about. So I'm going to go directly to some new information today. As of today, right now, we know that the USA does not dispute any of our evidence. They had up until today to present any of their own evidence or to explain to the commission or to us any defect in our evidence, and they have offered none. I also want to draw the commission's attention to a piece of recently submitted evidence. This is a document which was submitted as our exhibit number 27. It's actually a report of the U.S. Congress following their own investigation of these matters. And I want to draw the commission's attention particularly to a very striking portion of that history. You'll find on page 307 of that appendix a discussion of the fact, which has never been denied, never been disputed over all these years, and I can tell you was found to be extremely significant even to the U.S. courts in the course of settling one of these cases, that appears in the third paragraph on page 308, that when these people were brought by force from Peru to the United States aboard U.S.-flagged vessels, their citizenship papers were taken away from them, their passports. Any kind of proof of citizenship of any nation was demanded of them and never returned. Then, when they arrived in the United States of America put them through sham proceedings in which they were asked to produce citizenship documents. And of course, they didn't have them because the USA had already taken them. And on the basis of this fabricated evidence, all of the harms that you've heard about today were the foreseeable result. It is not only undisputed, it is simply impossible to reconcile this conduct with any notion of international law or even of justice at all. And I want to point to that, and I want to say on behalf of the petitioners that this business of taking away their citizenship papers and then condemning them as illegal for the lack of those citizenship papers in a kind of a ritual, for any of us who are familiar with legal proceedings anywhere in the world, this made a mockery of just proceedings of any kind. And it is a mockery which was reproduced when the United States of America made as their final settlement offer, which many of the victims of this scheme had to accept, that they would receive one quarter of the settlement amount and receive no apology for the specific facts of their treatment. In other words, the United States said to them, you are going to accept the fact that you are not equal. We're pretending to make amends and to apologize, but their apology was again a mockery of an apology, which Mr. Shibayama, the Shibayama brothers, could not accept. And it's this mockery of justice which I believe anyone who deals with law has to be shocked and repelled. Now, I'm just going to close by making a plea to the commission. I appreciate that the commission has its processes and its timetable, but I note for the commission's close attention, Article 29, Subsection 2A1, and Article 29, Subsection D. These subsections of the commission's rules grant it discretion in an extraordinary case like this, where the evidence is not disputed, the facts are cut and dried, and the abuse is shocking, to take steps for the extraordinarily swift resolution of this case. Under subsection 2, it's sad and inescapable that the petitioners will not be able to receive the benefits of the court's, of the commission's determination unless there is extraordinary speed in rendering that decision. And second of all, the current situation in the USA under 29 subsection D makes it clear that it is imperative that right now, today, this commission add its voice to those who are trying to persuade the United States to turn back on its current course of treating America as the first, the one, the master among nations, and demolish the citizenship rights of hundreds or thousands of people with the stroke of a pen. Now, as of today, the USA's own courts have been able to forestall the executive directives concerning immigration of the current administration, but they are resourceful people, and they seem to think that what they are doing is just fine. And in the name of humanity and the petitioners, I beg the court to add its voice as swiftly as possible to those that urge the United States of America with respect to respect the principles of international law, and use this case, which so closely relates to what's going on today. As you've learned, in this case, the United States of America again used its power to strip people of their rights of citizenship for its own purposes. I will yield the remainder of the time to Grace Shimizu.
You have 5 minutes.
Okay. My name is Grace Shimizu, and I'm the daughter of a Japanese national who resided in Peru for about 20 years and then was forcibly deported from Peru to the United States for internment during this hostage exchange scheme. And I'm also the director of the Japanese Peruvian Oral History Project, which is an organizational petitioner in this case. And just wanted to let you know that over the years, we've recorded a lot of our family stories. And over the years, we've maintained communication over, even though our families were dispersed after the war. And though many have passed away, the ones who are still surviving are watching this proceedings. They have an interest in finding out what happens to the Shibayama brothers and what this could mean for their own families. And then through our work too, we have met so many people, including the Germans, the Jewish people, the Italian people from Latin America who were also taken on the same boats and brought and put into the same types of camps. And they're watching too. This is a very important case, and I just implore you to please fulfill your mandate of protecting and upholding the human rights in the Americas by ruling in favor of the Shibayama brothers because of the war crimes and the crimes of humanity that was perpetrated against them. And I just wanted to underscore that for Art and his brothers, they were forced out of their home and their country. They were stripped of their home, their community, even their grandparents. They were stripped of their passports and identity papers. They were rendered stateless. And then they were stripped of their nationality. And then the U.S. government opposed a new identity, declaring them to be illegal aliens. But no human being is illegal. The government attempted to strip them of their humanity and dignity and tried to dehumanize them. They violated their rights, their human rights, with impunity. And one of the most fundamental of these is their right to liberty. They put them to detention as indefinitely. And this is not what should happen to any human being. And it shouldn't happen to children. And this is what the Shibayama brothers, they suffered. And so in terms of redress, because I know this time is very short, I just want to implore you to really look at what are the remedies available. Don't limit yourself to what the Japanese Americans got by the U.S. government, the Civil Liberties Act, the Mochizuki Settlement. Look to the world scene for all the types of human rights violations that have occurred and the types of justice that people have gotten. And if any of those apply to the brothers, they must be applied here. What we don't want is the standard for redress to be lowered. We don't want what we went through to be diminished such that now we get our humanity is valued less than others around the world too. So we implore you to please do the right thing and rule in favor of the Shibayama brothers.
Muchas gracias. Las preguntas de la comisionada Margaret May McCauley.
Yes, thank you very much. What, in effect, I get from this circumstance, this history of what happened to the brothers and their family and the effect on their family, and it's a continuing effect, in fact, is that, and what you spoke about the fact that their identity, travel documents, citizenship papers were taken from them, and then they were taken to a court,
so-called proceedings were heard, where they were expected to produce these same documents. As far as I'm concerned, I believe in, I speak very bluntly and call a spade a spade. That was fraud. That was clear fraudulent act. And the lawyer who acted in that proceeding committed professional misconduct. And I wonder if he's still alive, because I'm sure it was a he in those days. And because if he is, in my inherited British common law system, there is no time limit to take action on professional misconduct. Because if he's still alive, it can still be taken. And it ought to be taken. This is appalling.
Excuse me. It's my understanding that we weren't even accorded the right to a trial or a court. This was just processing into the country.
That's why I said proceeding, because what I've heard over the time I've been the commissioner here about the immigration proceeding system is appalling. I don't have any respect for the proceedings as in certain states. I shouldn't say in all states. One shouldn't generalize so much. But there's some states that it is terrible what goes on, even today. What happened then and happened with, as you mentioned, young children adversely affected by it, it's unacceptable. This is my personal view, and I'm sure it's the view of the commission. We cannot accept such a violations of rights, which are part of the declaration by which we can hold the United States accountable. And it is a pity that they're not here this morning, because it would have been so helpful to have put some questions directly to them about this matter. And we assure you that the commission will think very seriously about what we can do and cannot do. And you are entitled to the truth about what happened, the entire truth, to have the same published, to set the record and history straight. So we will definitely consider seriously what we can do in this regard, and hopefully bring your father some comfort and peace, and yourself.
Comisionado Paolo Vannucchi, por favor.
I will try to ask in English for the first time. my question is in the condition of rapporteur for Peru. I'm wondering and would like to know your assumption, and especially of Ms. Grace, about the no. If is there any small or not responsibility also of the state of Peru? Thank you. Yes.
Elizabeth.
It's a very brief question, and it has to do with people who were brought to the United States being Peruvian citizens whose documents, whose passports, whose identification papers would have been taken from them. In order to be recognized as citizens of the United States at later stages, was their Peruvian citizenship ever recognized by the United States later? In other words, was there some kind of process to have the recognition that they were not accorded when they arrived? Does that make sense?
Okay.
So that it was recognized years later, perhaps? Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Should I answer both questions?
Luego de formuladas estas preguntas y teniendo en cuenta que creo que los alegatos y los testimonios son bastante claros, otorgaría finalmente la palabra para los representantes, los peticionarios, para que respondan las preguntas formuladas o formulen cualquier comentario adicional que les parezca oportuno. Yo creo que con un tiempo de 4 minutos estaría bien. Por un tiempo de 4 minutos.
As far as the accountability of the nation of Peru, our understanding is yes, they share some responsibility for the events prior to the U.S. taking custody of the petitioners. Once the petitioners were in the custody of the United States of America, and in particular the seizing of their citizenship papers, bringing them to the United States and having brought them there, declaring them illegal intruders, immigrants into the United States. No, that the it is not our understanding that Peru has any responsibility for that, and nor does Peru have any responsibility for the later decision of the United States not to provide them with redress while providing redress to U.S. citizens who were relocated. As to the question of whether their prior citizenship ever was factored into their treatment.
Well, the truth is the U.S. government knew where they came from. They went there and picked them up. So there was never any question about who they were, what their citizenship was. They just pretended like they didn't know or they didn't have any papers like that. So the thing is that at some point, for those that remained in the United States, the internees, the immigration laws changed. That must have been in the 1950s, so that they could begin to change their illegal alien classification to the permanent residency. So people who learned about it, who happened to know about it, then took that opportunity. And then, so through that, I would say, yes, the government, you know, they have all these records. They know who's applying for these kind of change in status. So I don't know if that answers, but.
Mr. President, if you don't mind, what I wanted to know is if the U.S. government, in the process of granting permanent residency or citizenship, took into account formally, officially, that these were Peruvian citizens previously.
I think so. I think it's all in their records.
Thank you.
Would it be on the permanent resident document? I don't think I've ever seen one, so I don't know.
Yeah.
Is it there?
I would think so.
There's a transcript of a deportation proceeding included in the materials that have been submitted with the petition. And they were questioned about their citizenship, but I don't believe that when they were ultimately admitted for permanent residency in the United States, that there was that was based in any way on their former citizenship. So as I hear your question, I don't believe that ever factored into the United States of America's handling of these people.
Bien, agradecemos mucho los testimonios recibidos esta mañana, también los alegatos ofrecidos por los peticionarios. Lamentamos la ausencia del Estado, que no ha permitido que tengamos una visión más completa de estos asuntos, y damos por concluida esta audiencia, indicando que reiniciaremos la siguiente a las 10:15.